We can't afford it like episode. Already terribly constrained.
Another night at the opera. Those lucky enough to have tickets for tonight's 7 o'clock performance of Mozart's Marriage of Figaro have little idea of the real-life drama backstage. Geoffrey Black, who should be singing the role of the Count, can't. Within the last hour, he's lost his voice. By a stroke of luck, another celebrated baritone is available and on his way by taxi.
Can we
shorten the interval by 5 minutes?
No.
It takes that much time to change the set and to focus the lights and everything. We only just make it in half an hour as it is.
It is now 7:05. Thomas Allen was asleep in Fulham when the call came.
Well, can you fit him?
Hello, Jeremy. I'll be there soon.
Okay.
You'll not know me.
No problem, not your problem.
He was fine this morning.
Well, you're going to have a rain.
Hello, Captain. Hello, Captain. Going down a tide, 60.
I'll see you at the end. Stand you there. I'll leave you in their hands.
Give me that.
We just need to make sure the surtitles know as well.
Yes.
Yes. We're going to call in about a minute.
The curtain should have gone up 15 minutes ago. The general director, Jeremy Isaacs, has to placate a restive audience.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Thank you for your patience. I'm sorry to have to tell you that Geoffrey Black, who was going to sing the role of the Count tonight, is unwell and cannot do so. He was perfectly all right this morning when he warmed up an hour ago, here in the theatre, his voice had gone completely. We are fortunate to have secured another singer to assume the role of the Count. He is someone who will be familiar to you in the role in this production. His name is Thomas Allen. Mr. Allen flew from Los Angeles last night. I hope, therefore, you will excuse any vestige of jet lag that you detect in his performance. I hope you will give him the warmest of welcomes, and I hope you will enjoy tonight's performance of Il Nozze di Figaro. Thank you very much.
You didn't mention about the...
Oh, that's it. P.S. By a judicious optional cut in the last act, we hope to be able to bring the curtain down at the time that it would otherwise have come down, around 11 o'clock.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
Luckily, the Count doesn't make his entry until the middle of the first act. There is just time to get him into an over-large costume and to remind him of a few basic moves. He has not met the conductor. There's just a glimpse on a backstage monitor by way of introduction.
Do you work with him?
No. I wouldn't know who he was in the street. Oh, dear. I just go to sleep.
And he has never even set eyes on his wife, the Countess Rosina.
You met Christine. Yeah, there are a few embellishments.
How tall is she? I don't know.
A bit taller than me in high heels.
But substantial is this view. You better cut all this.
You better get in there. I think
you've got new furniture.
New furniture. I'm sorry. 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 I'm sorry
Ostandate, e scacciate il seduttor. Ostandate, scacciate il seduttor.
In mal punto son qui giunto. Perdonate, o mio signor.
Che ruin, mi meschino, sono presso dal dolor.
Ostandate, andate.
Thomas Allen made it successfully to the final curtain.
One down.
Tonight, the stage crew have to strike the opera set even faster than usual. The Royal Ballet is off to America, and the tour opens in just under 2 weeks with a big new production of Sleeping Beauty in Washington. The massive ballet set has to be packed into containers and on its way to Felixstowe by 4 a.m.
Ross has not been in yet.
In the opera house, sickness seems to strike at many levels. Timekeeper Ron Fennell logs the early morning calls from members of the stage crew who say they are indisposed. He's a busy man.
Pulled muscle in the rough right leg.
Might have dropped his wallet on his toe.
Sore nurse. Ice packs plus heat pad. That's good, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, there we go. You're going home. When somebody talks to you who you know, if they tell you a fib, you know that you just know. And when somebody talks to you and they're covering up something terrible, you know that as well. You don't know how you know, but you just know.
Well, I've got four runners tomorrow night, Ronald.
Will they win?
No.
I'll get these 20 past eight telling me who came in yesterday or who they say came in, because when I say about these people abusing the system, not coming in, management here don't always know who actually came in to work on overtime. So the information I get is not always right. Not that I'm Mr. Wonderful, of course.
Here we come.
Shylock, look, here he comes. Ken, have you been off this week?
Is
there any spaces on your card?
Yeah, why?
Can you tell me why? Please?
Yeah, because I've got a bad neck, that's why.
You see, this is the problem. You get an overtime sheet. This is for Wednesday. So I come in, it's supposed to have been checked yesterday. They've got a man down for 15 hours overtime who didn't come to work. This is from an assigned by a boss of a department. This came up so often.
Oh, you must be joking. Get that bloody thing out of my eyes first thing in the morning.
That was the favourite excuse, so we got the right spelling down so I didn't have to keep looking up in the dictionary, because you can have one day off of that, you see.
The stage crew's sickness record is only part of the problem. Today, Jeremy Isaacs will tell the board about plans for a radical shake-up of their schedule. The present rota enables two completely different shows and a morning rehearsal to be put on stage within 24 hours, at a price. The new plan will be cheaper and more flexible.
We're proposing a complete change in the way in which people work the stage. Very briefly, they work 15-hour days, 7 days a fortnight. So they hang around for long stretches of those 15 hours when they're not really needed, but they're all available at crunch moments of a big set change or a strike of a set or a build of a set when they are needed. And we're going to go over to a far lesser number of people called, in effect, by the hour, rostered hours. And the whole notion of half a fortnight of leisure, in which people are keeping fish and chip shops and playing golf and whatever, is going out the window, and that means that it's a complete change of lifestyle.
It's a microcosm of British society, in so much as they've never invested, relied heavily on the labour-intensive aspect of the job, and then what's happened is, as labour's got expensive, they've had to cut back, but they've got nothing to replace it with because they haven't invested.
They're throwing these ideas in, multi-skilling, we've got to do this, we've got to do that, but they can't make a stage person an electrician, they can't make an electrician a flyman overnight.
If we don't agree at the end of the day, I think they'll just impose a settlement on us.
People don't know whether they're going to be in a job in 6 months' time.
Bring him in, please.
The final interviews for a new director of personnel. On the panel are Jeremy Isaacs, from the board, industrialist Bob Gavron, and the director of finance, Clive Timms.
And I'm the person who got there, I think.
Bob Gavron?
Yes.
First in the hot seat is Mike Morris. He's a poacher turned gamekeeper. Once a trade union official, he's now personnel director of ITN. The house used to suffer from poor industrial relations, but things are improving. And the board now wants a new broom to sweep away what's left of the old practices and push through the new contract.
I don't think I've got a great deal more to offer ITN. And I suppose I'm slightly out of sympathy with its new spirit. I think I'd be that people have a right in a free society to belong to trade unions. And I think it's for management to reach an accommodation and deal fairly with them. And I've found always that if you do that, they respond. Well, a murky bit of my past. I was the father of the chapel. I led the only national strike there's ever been in television journalists. Something that I don't normally talk about.
Did you ever have a situation where industrial action was threatened at ITM?
The union instructed all its members to have nothing whatever to do with what they regarded as a blackleg workforce at TVAM. So the day arrived when I would have to go down and say to the duty engineer, I want you to feed this to TVAM. It's a bit like the nuclear deterrent. The other side has got to know you mean business, and that if they don't behave reasonably, that you will use the ultimate sanction.
If that chap had said no, that chief engineer, what would you have done?
I would have dismissed him. And then that faces the union with a problem, because they've got to decide, are they going to
pull everybody out?
Yeah. Mm.
Thank you very much for coming.
Okay,
thank you.
We'll give you a shout next week at the latest.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think this chap is an absolute ace, based on the interview and what I've heard. And you think that too, don't you?
Yes.
You've worked with him.
Oh, yes.
I also rather liked his answer about David Gordon. I mean, David is ideologically opposed to trade unions, and that's a mistake.
One, and two, and three, and four, and five.
As well as Sleeping Beauty, the tales of Beatrix Potter has to be rehearsed for the American tour. The pig has to dance on point. Men are not used to dancing this way. And it hurts.
Down. One, two, three, careful, 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 careful.
What's it like doing that?
Agony. Every girl I've ever dropped in my life on point to get in their revenge every second of it. This is meant to be on the toe to protect. I've worn it out. So.
What's it like? I mean.
It's just pure pain. I mean, just do it. Just sort of like take Nurofen and get up and do it, really. So. Under the mask, it's much easier because you can just sort of like show everything in your face as I did in the rehearsal.
Michael Nunn is one dancer who won't be going to the States. He's had a recurring problem with his ankle. It needs surgery, sooner rather than later, if he is to save his career.
It's my last chance now. I've tried everything. I've had cortisone injections, I've tried anti-inflammatory tablets, you name it, I've done it, acupuncture, massage. Nothing seems to work, so surgery is the last option. This afternoon I go into hospital. I don't even know what time the operation is yet because the surgeon is very busy. Probably about 3:30 they'll put me under and I'll probably come out about 4 o'clock and it'll all be done. And
the consequences of this not working?
Oh, the end of my career. Yeah, I mean, I'll have to think of something else. There's always going to be a risk. I always ask, you know, what are the chances? And they say, well, we can't tell you. Once we actually get in there, that's when we're going to know. It's quite nerve-wracking, really. I mean, it's worse than going on stage.
Morning, Judith.
Morning.
An internal candidate for Director of Personnel is the present number two in the department, Judith Vickers.
What would you say are your weak points, Judith?
I think my weak points are that I, from the point of view of skills, Because I haven't done, I didn't do the initial training, I did spend a lot of time when I first came here reinventing the wheel that I wouldn't have done if I'd actually had the basic skills to do it with. From my own personal skills, I think my main problem is that I tend to work off quite a short fuse.
Right.
And I'm fighting that very hard.
How does one fight that sort of thing?
I do the basic things like counting.
I have to say, Judith, when you stand there and say you people have got this wrong and what you are forgetting is, I always find it very helpful, however short a time it takes you to make up your mind to say it. Thank you, Judith, very much. Two candidates. You agree with that?
Yes.
She said about it. So, I mean, I think she's highly intelligent. She's self-aware in a very attractive way. She's altogether delightful, I think, and obviously has done wonderful work here in the past. The thing that worries me is, and I've heard it a lot now, the House will be worried at her appointment.
I mean, I know what you mean. I think it can be exaggerated, that. I mean, the fact is that this sharpness consists of saying rather abruptly at negotiating meetings, you people haven't got a leg to stand on, and that sort of thing.
But that can, of course, cause trouble. I think if I were to say what's in the back of my mind, I would really like to have both of those people in the House, if we could do that.
But she has infinitely more knowledge of the complexity and the reason of our arrangements than Mike Morris, who, you know, brashly states, you know, the Opera House needs sorting out like IDN and hasn't thought that that's more appropriately directed to part of the House, you know, than the whole of it. Hmm?
I think I said the same thing when I came for an interview, Jeremy.
I quite like that.
Fairly straightforward, it's just it's a slightly delicate little thing. Really. It's not a very big lesion, but normally it wouldn't affect what I would call a normal human being, but only affect ballet dancers or top-class athletes, really.
You have to think very carefully about operations on any dancer and make sure you don't do an unnecessary operation. You wonder, in fact, how the people manage to dance at all. And in fact, the first ballet dancer ever I examined, said, I asked her if she was in pain, and she looked at me very strangely, because they're all in pain. It's just a matter of, what do you mean by pain? I saw Dame Margot Fonteyn's feet for the first time. I couldn't believe she could stand up, let alone dance on.
We were hoping we'd have an extra bit of tendon there, which we could use as a sort of supplementary repair, which looks like he has, actually. There's the white tendon there, going yellow in that funny thickening, and that's where we shall oversew it. In a dancer, all the structures are very much stronger and overdeveloped, really. See that? That's quite very strong, do you see? Look at his range of movement. Right down there. Well, if you do anything to any of those joints to interfere with that range, you're going to wreck his career, basically.
Anthony Dowell, director of the Royal Ballet, is clearing his desk before leaving for America. At the last minute, he has to choose photos of Irek Mukhamedov and Darcy Bustle for a poster. With stars like these, it's the details that count.
With two artists such as Darcy and Irek, I expect they will have an input too and be asked.
What would they be sensitive about?
I'm not telling. But dancers look at their feet or their faces or the angle, the way the light is, the line they've made. His hand, the way he's supporting her here, looks like the fingers are going into the costume. Whereas here, the hand has come round in a better position. Doesn't look quite so strange. Of course, you've got to think that when they're being blown up, if we go to the biggest size that appears in the underground, you know, all those details show even more.
Michael.
This is Taylor.
It looks very nice. You're pink and healthy, I'm delighted to say.
Move your feet for Mr. Strawn a minute.
Can you mould your toes, Michael?
Michael.
That's it. Very good. That's fine.
The man from ITN got the job. Mike Morris is here to discuss the handover. Jeremy Isaacs expects him to take a firm hand.
It's Mike Morris to see Richard Wright.
The House needs a new stage agreement by the end of the season. Richard Wright, soon to retire, has handled the negotiations so far.
It's a sketchy thing, but I think it does give people a feel.
Mm.
Judith Vickers, personnel manager. She was runner-up for your job.
So I understand.
And in yes. really quite a difficult position. Because she's been doing that job before I came, so she's introduced me to my job here.
Mm.
And now she's got to do it again, another run with you. Mm. She had a lot of practice at it.
The other thing that I wondered whether you had were copies of union agreements.
Oh, God.
Do you really want them?
Mm.
Because they are...
Not today, necessarily, no. But... It would be helpful for me to...
Yeah, I mean, we've got massive union agreements. I think Watch is on.
Mm.
They're boring.
I know, but... okay. They're an important part.
I mean, we have the MU, we have the structure. Equity, and we have Vectu. I'm sure it'll probably seem like 5 minutes when we come back.
I know.
So, a ticket and... A
passport.
It will somehow wing its way tomorrow.
Materialise, yeah.
All right, sit
on. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Safe journey.
Yes, funny feeling. I think it's where the fun really starts now, because although we were pressured and rushed at the Opera House, you knew you didn't have to deliver the goods. Now we're going to be pressured and short of time, but we've got to deliver the goods, and the profile of that first night, gala audience and Princess Margaret and the President of the United States, I mean, it's the big time. And also because Sleeping Beauty is sort of hallowed ground, it's a signature piece of the company. So God knows what it's doing to my system. I shall probably give birth to sort of... 6 ulcers.
If people are genuinely sick, we can't discipline.
Mike Morris starts as he means to go on. First on the receiving end are the managers in charge of the stage crew and Judith Vickers, now his deputy.
How does this tie in with a new sickness procedure that I've been sending out, the technical department sickness absence?
Since the beginning of March, the only person who's transgressed this code of practice
yes.
is Mr. Fletcher. Right, well, let's start with him, shall we?
Okay.
What does he say is wrong with him?
Oh, everything and everything. Bad back, neck, shoulder, leg, ankle ill.
Okay, well, let's get in. Let's start with him. As people fall foul of the new regulations, mm-hmm. so we haul them in, but
fine.
Immediately. That's
yep.
the key.
Fine.
Yeah?
Okay.
I mean, if they're late today, we want them in today.
Fine. Okay.
If they've been off sick for 3 days, when they next come in,
okay.
and if we're not satisfied that it's genuine, mm. straight away, then, because the whole essence of discipline is immediacy.
Mm.
And it may be worth putting the word out that things are changing.
I think it's gone around already.
Okay. The word is that. When the hard decisions have to be taken, inevitably, if you're a personnel director, you don't get loved. But, you know, so what? That's life.
You don't need to be.
I don't need to be, no. I mean, I have a loving and supportive private life. I don't come here for that. Some people do. I mean, for a lot of people, this is home. And I think that's something one has to be aware of.
You can do 200 hours of FOSS week. You get no overtime. You still only get your basic money.
Jerry Morrissey, chief negotiator for the stage crew union,
yes.
Bechtu, hasn't met Mike Morris. But the new man's reputation has gone before him. At ITN, he pushed through a controversial change in the way overtime was calculated, basing it on annual rather than weekly figures, so the staff made less.
And said, Mike Morris has taken over. And the first thing that ran into my head was, shit, annualised hours.
I mean, his opening line was he was very worried about our social time and how much time we get off to spend with our families.
I can see that, yeah.
Yeah,
that's
great.
I've been off for this morning.
Hello, Larry.
It's crazy, isn't it?
Good morning.
Jerry Morris, eh?
Squeeze out of here.
Mike Morris.
Nice to meet you, Jerry.
Good to meet you.
Yeah.
I don't know how we've never come across each other all these years.
No.
There it is.
Yeah.
Right. Where do we normally sit?
Well, anywhere.
Anyway. If you think that there need to be changes in the way the House is organised, the House is managed, the technical department is managed, I want to know about it. Because we all have a common aim here.
I think perhaps
we want it to be better. Mm. We want it all to be better. In some ways, this organisation is still living in the 1970s. The kind of trade union agreements that have gone everywhere else still exists here, and industrial relations goes on in the opera as though the Thatcher period never happened.
Sets and costumes for the Royal Ballet's tour of America fill 17 containers. They will be unloaded in New York and driven down to Washington, the first stop of the tour.
Time to get them dispatched down to Washington.
That hatch right now, Neil. Some of them are off. The rest of them will be off soon, and they'll be ready for you to take them out the gate.
All right, because they have to be down there tomorrow morning, so I want to get them set up with the truckers and everything.
A skeleton crew from London goes on tour with the ballet. The stage crew chief at the Kennedy Centre is Mickey Berra. In stark contrast to Covent Garden, he has a fully up-to-date stage, and with none of the pressures of a repertory system, he needs only a small but well-paid permanent crew.
I think that we are very well paid, but after this show leaves, I will have 9 people that will stay here and work. The other 31 of those will go out and hope that they can get work at other theatres.
Yeah.
Because like there's that space on that side, we'll lose right in there.
These walls on the inside.
It's no problem
walls.
Whatsoever.
And the party will begin.
Hey. Emma.
Welcome back.
Nice to see you
again.
Good to see you again.
Good to see you. Everything is super.
Yeah. Really?
Oh, yeah.
It's like unloading the
QE2. We love it.
Back at Covent Garden, the schedule demands a permanent night crew. Mike Morris has come to see what they actually do in the small hours.
Hi, Mike Morris.
Hi, Mike Morris.
Anyway, if we start at the top, you can see what happens up there.
Okay.
We'll work our way down. Has anyone taken the photo?
Sorry again?
Has anyone taken the photo?
I've been up to the grid once.
You imagine this lot when we act the world in their wife all in the building.
It's been a very, very heavy.
The last 5 years have been very heavy.
And the last 5 years. It's like electric trains, isn't it? You've got to have more control.
It's like electric trains, except you've got you've got the capability of 38 ton lifting power on chain hoists.
No, I don't know the answer to that problem.
I do.
But go on, tell me.
Get new managers. Because they're obviously not very good at their job.
No, that's not fair. You know, the sheer effort of getting a new idea in place.
Well, it's more like the sheer effort of fighting 100 years of laddism.
No, you've got it.
To be quite honest.
Yeah, that's it, you see.
I spent 10 years building this calf up. I suppose I can get it back again fairly shortly. But there's nothing left of it, really. It's gone.
Can you flex it?
My foot?
No, your calf.
No, that's it. Nothing. Nothing at all.
Right, morning, dear. Michael.
Right. How is it?
Okay.
You can't tell yet, can
you?
Not
really, no.
No.
I'm dreading actually trying to walk on it or anything yet.
While Michael Nunn worries about his future, his colleagues take off for Washington. They'll be away from home for 5 weeks.
Old days when they first travelled to America, all the girls were made Dior suits to get off of the plane on, so that when they arrived, everyone stepped down from the plane in their little Dior number. I mean, you want to see us not get off a plane? It's like jeans and swollen ankles.
The world premiere of a new production would normally be at Covent Garden, but for budgetary reasons, the accountants allocated the new Sleeping Beauty to the next financial year. Now it will open at the Kennedy Center in Washington. There's plenty of space here for the huge set, and even for some fun and games backstage.
That's a shot.
Time is tight, but designer Maria Bjornsson is still making tiny adjustments to her set.
Up to here, and then it starts going off slightly, doesn't it? The lettering hasn't followed the shape of the book at the bottom. That's what I mean.
Yeah, don't follow the book.
That's doing that, isn't it? I really think we've got to look at it from further away, so it wouldn't be actually
sure, is it? Even Anthony Dowell has been co-opted to help repair a backdrop.
It's a good tension. Therapeutic. I think it could be. I was just thinking I should take one out front on the first night and sit and do it. Sit and fiddle.
Leanna Palmer is one of the corps de ballet.
There's only one way to get water out of your washing.
She shares a hotel room with her sister, Vanessa. There's not much you can tell them about life on the road.
You fill the bath up as though you're going to get in it, but with washing liquid, and you just sort of do a dance on them.
When did you discover this?
Japan. 5 weeks without a washing machine.
We got hysterical.
We got so many blisters in our thumbs that we decided to resort to primitive. Since dry.
The Royal Ballet flies the flag when it goes abroad. The British ambassador has invited the company to a reception so the Washington establishment can make small talk with big stars like Darcy Bustle.
They've got a brand new theatre. All I know is it's right next to the shopping arcade.
Hello, welcome.
Ambassador, thank you very much indeed for your kind welcome. It is a major event for us and the Royal Ballet on Wednesday. It is a world premiere of a new production. It's a pleasant change to leave our 19th century Victorian theatre and come to the Kennedy Centre with its modern stage and its modern facilities. And it's also something of a pleasure to escape from the politics of London and Great Britain, dominated as they are by a succession of sexual scandals and questions as to the competence of those in authority to govern, and to leave all that behind and to come here to Washington,
Back at base, Mike Morris isn't finding things any easier. The chorus is up in arms. The shop steward has abandoned today's rehearsal to complain about what his members believe is a serious breach of contract.
Well, I mean, as I said, I'm not absolutely convinced the chorus will accept that at all, I'm afraid. You know, I think that the contract has been infringed, so therefore there needs to be some sort of penalty payment to actually recognise the fact the contract has been infringed. But I'll put it to the chorus and see what they say.
Okay. The story begins with the relay to the big screen. Last night, we've got this arrangement whereby we relay live performances to the piazza on a big screen. And last night we did Fedora with Jose Carreras. Tonight we're doing Carmen with Placido Domingo. And very nice it is for everybody. So, there's a restaurant, which is slightly raised up, with a good view of the screen. And some monitors, which show the relay that's on the big screen, placed in this restaurant. Unbeknown to me, unbeknown to anybody who's had anything to do with the agreement with the chorus, which states very clearly that the relay's only to the big screen, not to anywhere else. So, technically, breach of the agreement.
It's a breach of the contract, and the chorus are not happy with it. Neither are the orchestra, I believe.
It's extremely rude to be treated in such a cavalier fashion. And if they feel they can do this sort of thing, well, one wonders what they've either done before or want to do in the future.
We're seen as the villains of the piece. I mean, we want opera to be seen by people that can't afford £100 a ticket. At least, I think most of us do, and we don't want to be looked upon as the sports of the thing. We want ordinary people to see opera, and this is a great occasion to do it. But there's a lot of potential for this to go out and people to make money in that piazza.
So I've called the Equity National Officer in here and said, now listen, but there is a law, and the law says no industrial action without a ballot or 7 days notice. And I said, I want an undertaking from you that there's going to be normal work tonight, big screen or no big screen, or I'm going for an injunction. And he's accepted that, and he's gone to tell them. I said, if you want to talk about a payment for last night, the answer's still no, but put it into dispute, and we'll go through the proper procedure. And as far as I know, they're meeting now to decide what they're going to do next. It's a storm in a teacup, and Placido Domingo will appear tonight on the big screen.
With chorus.
With chorus. Carmen without a chorus would look rather odd, I think. It takes me back, is all I can say. It takes me back. We used to have this in television all the time, you know. But I haven't had this sort of what one might call coarse industrial relations for a very, very long time. Very, very long time. Jeremy, I just thought you'd like to know, I've had an undertaking from Equity that tonight's performance will be worked normally. Okay? Bye-bye then.
A final costume check in Washington for Sleeping Beauty. Darcy Bustle will dance the title role. She's had several minor injuries lately, and her last rehearsal in London did not go well. The tension is beginning to tell.
What's it like as you're waiting in the wings to go on for that
one? I try not to think about it. I just aim to go out there to enjoy it.
What is it that you're having to do that is hard on the body?
It 1 minute turning one way and then turning the other from out of a lift. So it's just like sort of jarring. But my partner's doing it for me, so it's not like I can control the turn. If I could control it, I could probably prevent it from doing any damage. Well, that hurts.
For good historical reasons, an American president is always wary of trips to the theatre. They say the extra security for tonight will cost $40,000.
And or.
Nothing is left to chance.
We're on at 7.
Some things might be related to it. It's a very soft stage here. So the loading on the body is slightly different. That might have something to do with it. There's a lot of nerves going on as well.
Who are you organising this time?
This time?
What do you mean, Zoe?
Zoe,
have
you seen this?
You need to take your shoes and your wig now, because we need to take it up past all the security. So it doesn't go in the middle of the show.
Best stuff I've had on it.
You beat?
I beat, yeah. The wings beat.
I'm beat free.
You beat free? Yeah, oh my God. That's the funniest thing ever. I've never had to go on stage through a beat machine before.
The sniffer dog is going to be in.
It's outrageous, isn't it? Outrageous.
Princess Aurora, the Sleeping Beauty of the title, is the most technically demanding role in the repertoire. It's the pinnacle for any ballerina who wants to prove herself a major star. From the first moment on stage, she has to launch into a series of virtuoso routines. In this production, to cap it all, Darcy Bustle has to make her first grand entrance down some steep and awkward steps. The stakes could not be higher.
She needs a little groin, but she's very gorgeous, and she has a gift of getting the audience on her side even when she isn't secure, which is wonderful. You saw them cheering in there, it was very nice.
Oh, Darcy Bustle was wonderful. I thought she gave a glorious performance, as ever, in very difficult circumstances.
In the next act, the designer has created an extraordinary theatrical moment. When the prince kisses the sleeping princess, she wakes, and a huge spider's web seems to blow away.
OK, there you go.
Go.
Go, Bob.
The last act has a series of exhausting solos for all the principals. But what everyone's waiting for is the ballet's climax, a run of glittering set pieces for the prince and princess. The prince, Zoltán Solymózy, also has injury problems. So far, so good, but he'll go on practicing right up to his big solo. The three-hour marathon for Darcy Bustle is almost over. So far, her troublesome ankle has carried her through, but a twisted joint or pulled muscle could still cause havoc.
Oh, come on! Please!
I'll take you on. We'll just
and then
do a bow.
For
yes.
Okay, Becky. Can you get your basket? Get your basket. Forward again, go forward again. Okay, Becky, stand by the page, please. Okay, going through. Came through the caliber, please.
Won't go back.
Jeremy Isaacs and Baroness Blackstone, chairman of the Royal Ballet Board, are the first to turn up backstage.
Standing by the clothes. And clothes, please. How about Becky? Thank you very much. Okay, can we line up for the presentation, please?
Next time, I'll show your teeth.
Right.
We only saw it once in the coda. You've got it over with now, so...
Now we can really perform it, hey, Daddy?
Oh, yes. Where shall I do it? Come along. You belong with the king and queen. All right. Now, Ralph, go back there. We'll take one with the whole company. What do you think? Can you get us all in?
In a shower cap.
The first ballet I ever attended in my entire life was in Covent Garden. Covent Garden is still in bloom. I've seen Miss Farrell dance in New York. She didn't believe me when I told her. I've been going since 1982.
Yes. No, but I don't get complimented.
Thank you so much.
It's so kind of you to come.
I'm very honored to meet you. I hope I see you when I'm leaving. No,
I can't believe you ever asked.
See you dancing again next time.
Just wait till I'm the owl in Beatrix Potter. That'll really do it.
The song Tony, You're the Best, because that's Anthony Dow, and he doesn't like being called Tony.
My flowers, I haven't opened my cards.
Okay.
I feel a bit of a scratch bag.
Hi.
Come on, yes, come on, you all come in.
What table?
It's all right, they'll know you.
Soon after the Washington opening, Darcy Bustle's ankle gave way. After surgery, she had to hang up her ballet shoes for 9 months. She couldn't dance the gala nights in New York or later at Covent Garden. Michael Nunn's surgery worked, and he rejoined the company at the beginning of the next season. Darcy Bustle has also recovered, and she's dancing again, as well as ever.